Well, good afternoon, everybody. Hey. Welcome to Freedom Church / St. Paul's Church. It is awesome to be able to gather together in a building, in the dry, and just what a blessing, eh? What a blessing to be able to be here. It's great to see so many of you. So thanks for coming out and for braving the weather and for committing to be here, because this is valuable. It's valuable family time together, and it's great that we can do this. Well, we haven't got a clue what we're doing. We found these things, instruments and microphones. This is all very highly unfamiliar, but we are thrilled that we get to be able to sing and play music again after all this time. So we're going to kick off with a family song, My Lighthouse. Kids, do you know that one? Who knows My Lighthouse? Super. If you'd like to come to the front, whoever that was, grab a microphone. Hey, we're going to sing together. Would you like to stand? If you'd like to dance, there is literally all of this space at the front of the church. Feel free to use it. We are not precious. In my wrestling,
in my wrestling, and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your loving love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, I will trust a promise. You will carry me safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore.
I can see some people doing the actions. Let's have some more of that if you know them.
I won't fear what tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Whoa, my lighthouse. My lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore. Safe to shore.
Let's sing fire.
Fire before us, you're the brightest. Through the storms, fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through
fire.
Oh, fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the fire before us, you're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore, safe to shore.
Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let's sing Worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Oh, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. So worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, 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 oh. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh. One with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory and creation now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is.
What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us. So Jesus, you brought heaven down. My sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave.
Let's sing this out, come on.
The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. It's yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of.
You have no rival.
You have no rival. You have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. It's yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus.
Come on, let's lift up a shout in this place. Hallelujah.
Praise you, Lord.
Amen. Well, why don't we pray together? Father, we're so grateful to be in this space this afternoon. Lord, what a joy it is just to lift up your name, to worship you. To just fix our gaze. Whatever has been going on this week, to just fix our gaze on you in these moments. Knowing that you are here, that you are amongst us, that you are moving amongst your church. Lord, we just want to commit this time to you. We're here for you, that's why we gather. And we just pray that over these next few moments together, Lord, that you are going to mightily move in our midst. We take a moment to just bring to mind, Lord, those things that are going on in life that we're struggling with. And we just consciously and intentionally lay them down at your feet. We cast our cares upon you because we know, because your word tells us that you care for us. So in this moment, we look to you, we glorify you, we praise you, and we thank you for everything you're doing, everything in this community, everything on this island, everything in our families, our friendship groups. Lord, we thank you where we see you at work in all of those places. We glorify your name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Why don't we thank the worship team? How good is it to have you guys back? Thanks, guys. You can take a seat. Well, as Phil said, welcome to Freedom at St. Paul's. And firstly, we don't take this for granted, being able to use this space this afternoon. It has come through the amazing generosity of the guys at St. Paul's, the St. Paul's team, who have just been, they've been so good to us in so many different ways, with the kids' spaces, the youth spaces. So even though there may not be any of them here, can we just put our hands together and thank St. Paul's for letting us be here? This is very much our next step on our journey of reimagining church. And we've been saying all summer that it's not about the building or the place that we meet, but it's about the people and the community. And we're going to take a bit of today to reflect on that and what we think God has been saying over the past 3 months. But before we get into that, a couple of little bits of housekeeping to entertain you with, you know, get the exciting stuff out of the way first. The first is, if you are going to the ball, which is coming up very quickly now, 2 weeks, 2 weeks away. If you're going to the ball and you've told Di or Serena that you're coming to the ball, please could you transfer your payment for the ball, because Di will know. And she's putting the tables together this weekend, and she can't confirm your place until you've paid the money and let either Di or Serena know. So if you are coming to the ball, the Burkina Faso ball, 2 weeks' time, could you just make sure you transfer your payment? And also, if you have done that, you will have received an email from Diane asking for your menu choices, which is also very exciting. Please, can you send them back? Otherwise, they may get chosen for you, and you might end up with the vegan option. I'm joking. There's no offense there to any vegans in the house. So that's the ball. That's coming up. Another thing to just make you aware of, which I think is really interesting, is this Friday and Saturday, and this has been organized by the town church. There's a couple of apologetics events. There's a guy coming over from the UK, a guy called Andy Bannister, and he's coming over, and on Friday night, he's doing a talk called Pain, Pandemics, and Putin. And he's talking about the relevance of Christ in our current culture and our current cultural moment. On Friday night, I believe it's at the Monterey Hotel at 7 p.m., really interesting title of the talk, and this guy, this is what he does. He goes and he defends the gospel of Jesus, and he puts it into culture, and he explains why it's relevant, how it's relevant to everything that's going on now. If you're interested in that sort of thing, or you know people that might be, these are often great things to invite someone that's just like wrestling with the idea of faith and the relevance of faith in today's day and age. Friday night could be a really good thing to take someone to or invite someone to. It's all free. That's Friday night. There's some flyers, by the way, in the foyer that you can pick up afterwards if you are interested. And then on Saturday morning, next Saturday, in the town church building, they're running a morning that they're calling Confident Christianity. And again, same guy, Andy Bannister, but he's going to focus specifically on how do we build our confidence in sharing God's amazing message into what is quite a tough cultural environment. That's the whole point of next Saturday morning. And again, if perhaps that's something that you wrestle with, perhaps you think, I'd love to know how to share the gospel better or how to answer some of the tougher questions, then next Saturday, it's free as well. The whole morning is going to be dedicated to that. It's called Confident Christianity. Again, there's flyers that you can pick up on the way out. So either of those two things, put them in your diary if you're interested at all. Now, we've obviously been in the field for the past 3 months. This is just a moment of honesty. Did anyone turn up to the field this morning? Good, me neither. But what an amazing season we've had there. What a great 3 months it's been. I don't think even when we were planning going into the field that we could have envisaged quite how powerful these 3 months would have been and formative in a lot of different ways. It feels to me that it really has been a season of joy. Now, Micah has put together a really good short highlights video of some of the stuff that went on in the field. So if the tech works, we're going to show that to you right now.
Welcome to Freedom Church in the field.
When Jesus uses this word ecclesia, he's essentially saying, what I'm establishing here is a kingdom.
If you've invited Jesus to be king in your life, you've become a priest, an ambassador.
When the scaffolding has gone away, though, what is left behind the scaffolding?
Today, we're talking about being marked by hope, by unity, by love.
They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. It sounds all hunky-dory, right? He says, repent. That's hard.
Prayer. It is vital.
Our focus must be first on Christ and then on fellowship.
Today, I'm going to talk about the church being like a body, as a holy priesthood,
as an army. We've been reimagining church.
To know Christ and to make him known.
Amazing. It's been a fun time. And we're aware, and even in that, we're aware how much we covered over the 3 months when it came to church and all of the scriptural references on church. So today what we're going to do, in a minute I'm going to let the kids and young people go out, is just stop and breathe for a Sunday, and we're going to reflect a little bit on some of the big things that came out of the field. So I'm excited for the next few moments. It's going to be a chance to just sort of gather together a little bit what we think God has been doing. It's easy in church life, isn't it, just to run forward from series to series to series, and you realize there's just so much content coming at you all the time that you haven't even processed the last set, and there's more coming. So today's going to be a bit of a slower, more reflective style in our message, and Tim and I are going to chat about that in a minute. But now is the moment for kids and young people to head out. Now, I think a lot of you will have pre-registered. If you haven't, there's going to be kids team out there who can take you across. It's all over in the St. Paul's Centre. If you're youth, why don't you gather just outside the front doors, inside the railing, and Claudia and Ryan can show you where to go. Claudia's there as well, so you'll be able to see her. And while all of that is going on, why don't you turn to someone around you and share a memory of the field, if you were there at all. Share your favorite memories. What did you take from it? Go ahead.
Hey. Hello. Great, some good conversations there. I wonder if there's any wisdom in the room, any reflections people have got of the summer that they want to share. Please feel free, heckle it out, because that's what we want to keep. We want to keep the... In fact, Mary was just saying about meeting in the field. She loved it because it was like being with a friend when you've got no makeup on and like you've not had to make an effort to kind of do something or perform in a specific way, but you could just be there and be real. And so with some of the things that we're used to stripped away, there's like a rawness and we want to keep it, you know. And so that's what I heard from Mary. I reckon there's a load more treasure in the room. Anything else that people... Did someone say boo? Oh, I thought you went boo. That would have been a lot worse. Food. Joel says food, and that's because he's a human male. Well done, Joel. Yeah, I completely agree. There's something special about the table, isn't there? And kind of sitting and taking time and getting to know people. And that real space of food and sharing, serving one another. Yeah, anything else? Seeing the church community back together again. What do you find particularly about that, Jez?
Just encouraging us after the pandemic.
Yeah. It was like it was a kind of step back in moment for a lot of people, I think. So, like getting back together. It's like getting the gang back. yeah, totally. The unstructuredness. Yeah. Yeah, I was conscious, like, years ago, I was with a mate as he preached in a pub in Bournemouth, and someone won the jackpot at the same time as he came to the climax of his message. It was really unstructured. And this was a bit like that, wasn't there? I was aware, at one point we were talking about being marked by love, and there was a kid swinging in the background, and another one sort of running across like this, and it was just family moments. Yeah, loved it. Yeah, there's something beautiful about that, isn't there? Yeah, love that too. Love that.
Worship more than a song.
Yeah, worship is more than a song. You know, I love the times where we sing. They're like, it's like we take 20 minutes to redirect our focus, and there's only one thing you're sort of looking at, hopefully. But the fact is, worship is outside of the bounds of just music. It is music too, but it's the whole of life and everything we're doing. So yeah, like there's an emphasis on that. Anything else?
Breaking the mold.
It's good. I've loved how much has come out of the whole church. Do you know what I mean? It's almost like when God thought about his body, there'd be each part would be playing its part and there'd be life springing up everywhere. We're going to talk more about this stuff, but breaking the mold of worship gave us an opportunity to step out of the frameworks that we've got used to. Yeah. Yeah, nice. Like, okay. Solana was saying she had a picture of like a present, like a box. And every week it was like there's a different present to open. There was something new, something different and exciting. So, yeah.
It didn't rain till today.
I mean, like, I do love that. I mean, like, if we were claiming it, we'd go, hasn't God been good to us? And the sun shines only on us, and then, you know... And then the day we come back in, it hammers with rain. I love it. It's brilliant. It's been great. Great stuff. Well, you know, we're gonna sort of open this journey up a bit. But I want to give you a little bit of context. I shared it with some small group leaders and some guys who are maybe wanting to break into leading small groups. not long ago, I was spearfishing, mask and snorkel, and you swim around with a mask and snorkel on and try and shoot your supper, like the last bastion of unregulated hunting. And I dropped down, and I was lying on the bottom of the sea, and I was frantically looking around for fish, excited. In fact, pumped, because I love it, right? So I'm looking around, and I'm realizing I'm kind of amped, and I'm using oxygen quickly, okay? And I just felt like God said to me in the moment, which made perfect sense for fishing, everything slowly, everything slowly. And then, while I'm on the bottom of the sea, I almost dropped my gun to the floor and just completely was thinking about church. And I was thinking about how so regularly it feels like everything quickly. Like, get it done, meet with some people, do some, you know, serve on a team, go and pray for some people, and leave, and breathe. And I felt like God was saying, everything slowly. We're on this journey together that is marked by hope, and by love, by grace. We're on a journey together. When you're on a journey from Spain to France, you just take it one step at a time. You just bite off a chunk at a time. And I felt like God was saying to us as a church, everything slowly. Let's take a moment. Let's realize what God's doing in this moment. Let's breathe a bit. And just because we're back in a building doesn't mean we've lost that journey. There's a sense that God has got us pacing out like a new thing. And let's do it everything slowly, one step at a time. No rush, just breath and hearing him and stepping with him. I wonder if you could just be quiet for a minute. Lord, we're so grateful to you that in a world that got itself in a big hurry, we can breathe you in. We can be on a journey with you, step by step. We can enjoy that journey. We can allow you to breathe into us your new life every step of the way. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So we've loosely titled today, Do You Remember When? And the idea, as Tim is saying, is that it becomes a bit of a reflective afternoon, but just something that you guys can also then go away and think about and not let the word of God depart from what he's been doing in each of you. And we've come up with, we've been chatting, and we just came up with three memories that we have from the last 3 months and what we think that God has been saying through them that we're going to continue sort of pursuing and thinking about and wrestling with as we go on. So the first one that came to mind for me was that first week in the field. Now, I don't know if you were there for that, but for those of you that were there, you'll remember that not only had we just had the news that we couldn't use any acoustic instruments, and we couldn't amplify anything, but also the tent was late. And so we sat literally in a field on chairs. And I remember looking around and Tim talked about how all of the scaffolding had gone. And on that Sunday, we'd planned to, before we knew all of this was going to happen, but we planned to talk about the word ecclesia. And so I shared a little bit on that first Sunday of this word ecclesia, that for whatever reason, Jesus decided when he's speaking in Matthew 16 to 18 to 19, he's speaking to Peter. He says, I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And he uses this word ecclesia. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And we spoke about this crazy idea of the ecclesia being this established kingdom of God wherever any of us are. So if we're out at work, if we're with our family, if you understand what Jesus was talking about when he spoke about this word ecclesia, he was saying actually wherever you are, the government of God's kingdom is. And we started speaking about the power of that. And that resonated right back then with me. But over the course of the 3 months, I feel like God has just been layering that on. This slight re-emphasis or this shift from thinking about the power of the church in the gathered to the power of the church in the scattered. And that's not to diminish the power of the gathered. So don't get me wrong. I'm not going to sit here and say we shouldn't be meeting like this on Sunday. This has value and this is power and this has purpose. But I feel like what God has been saying over the course of these months is that actually there's a season now to also think very carefully and diligently about what does it mean for each of us when we go back into our Mondays and into the rest of our week. What does the church scattered look like? And if you remember, Tim started using this language of micro church and macro church. But contrary to what you might think it is, micro church we started speaking about as this. So when the church gathers together, this is actually the micro expression of church. And it's when we go out into the world, say, I don't know, if there's 150 people in this room, suddenly tomorrow and across this week, we have 150 different expressions of God's kingdom in different spaces in Jersey. That is the macro expression of God's church. And as I was thinking about that and reflecting on it, I came up with an analogy, which I've tried literally zero times, so this could go well or it could go badly. But this is the picture I have of micro and macro that I've been reflecting on. It wasn't just that I was really thirsty. This is concentrated squash. And like any good speaker, I took the label off to make sure I wasn't accidentally advertising something. You never know in today's day and age. This is like what happens when we gather today. It's a very concentrated expression of the kingdom of God, right? We've got a whole load of people at various stages on their faith journey. But generally, we have Christians in the room, and we get together, and we worship God together. And there's this concentrated expression of, yes, Jesus is king, and we are God's people. The trouble is, if we keep it like this, and now we all go into our week and almost forget that we are God's people, and we've just come because we come on Sundays, this nicely concentrated expression of God's kingdom just remains here in the corner. And we'll come back to it next week, and it will be concentrated again, and it will be great, and we'll be encouraged, and we'll be empowered. But when we've been talking about micro and macro church, we've been saying, actually, I think the power of this next season is that we come together in gatherings and we think about who God is and we encourage each other. But the purpose of us coming together is to equip one another for the works of ministry. Because then, as we go out into our day-to-day, I'm sorry if you can't see this, all of us are going with our little bit of the kingdom because we understand what the ecclesia is, right? Wherever you are, so is the kingdom of heaven. And suddenly, now, instead of one vessel that looks a bit deep purple, we've now got five vessels that start to look a bit purple. And then we come together again, whether it's in a small group, whether it's on a Sunday, and we encourage each other, and the depth of the purple, the rich intensity of God's kingdom is reimagined, and we think about it, and we spend time in it, and then out we go again into our week. And we say, look, I can drop a little bit of kingdom here because of the ecclesia is where I am. The ecclesia is where I am. Do you get the picture? It's quite a simple analogy, but suddenly instead of one vessel that's very deep purple, we've got hundreds of vessels which are slowly starting to change color. And now if you think of the Lord's Prayer, when Jesus teaches us to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. This is the picture that I have. And this is something that for me just came out over the time in the field. And I think this is a journey we're going to continue to be going on. Rather than coming in, we're going to talk about a lot what it means to go out, to equip you so that you feel like wherever you are, whatever you're doing, you've got backing, you've got support, you've got encouragement, and you've got affirmation to go and be the kingdom of heaven wherever you are in whatever sphere. That, I think, is something that's really come through strong over the past 3 months. To the extent that we as a leadership team have started actively looking for training from outside voices for people that are already doing this really well across the UK. And we spent a day last Tuesday on an online conference run by a group called the London Institute for Contemporary Christianity that spend their whole lives thinking about what it means to equip Christians in the workplace and in their spheres of influence. And we allowed ourselves to be trained by them. And one of the little exercises that they came up with, which I thought was really good, and I'm just going to throw it out to you now for a moment of 30 seconds of reflection, is whenever you come together on a Sunday in the concentrated expression of the kingdom of God, you ask the question amongst yourself, where will you be this time tomorrow? TTT, this time tomorrow. And for 30 seconds to a minute, everyone takes a moment to think, actually, it's now 4:47. At 4:47 tomorrow, where are you going to be? Who's going to be around you? Who's going to be with you? What purpose has God got for you in that space this time tomorrow? So I want to do that now, just 30 seconds. Have a think. Where are you going to be this time tomorrow? As we just reflect on something that's coming out of this time in the field, and we think about what it means to be the ecclesia elsewhere. 30 seconds, moment of reflection. Squash is delicious.
So I hope that's been an interesting exercise. By the way, you can take that one away and have a think. Okay, right, what does my Monday look like? How do I carry what God's doing into my space? You know that you occupy a unique space in this world. You occupy a unique space in this world. Stop trying to be someone else. I heard someone say, actually, there's no one else who can be you. You've got to be you. And God has commissioned you and he's placed you. And he's placed you in a space that is uniquely shaped around who you are. Sometimes it's difficult to see that because it's tricky, isn't it? It's tricky life sometimes. But actually, God has placed you uniquely in a space. back in February, I was dreaming quite a lot last year. I had quite a few different dreams. But one of the dreams I had was just a really simple dream. And it was just of a wheat field, and in this wheat field there were little fires beginning, which actually wildfires are a bit of a nightmare really, but I got the word wildfires, and these little fires were happening across this big field. Okay, I don't know if you've been to, it was like the reverse of November the 5th bonfire, where there's a big fire in the middle of a field. Now, there was these little wildfires sort of springing up across the field. And I didn't really know what it was specifically that God was saying. But over this time in the field, it's become quite clear to me that God was speaking about the joy for me being in seeing pockets of life independently springing up across this field. Little pockets of fire, little pockets of life that can grow and spread. So that was like a key thing for me. And actually over the 3 months, there's been little pockets of life springing up. There's been the intercession space, which has been such like a joy to be part of. Like a real joy, which is amazing, isn't it? Because when you talk about prayer meetings in church, you feel like people dragging themselves to prayer meetings. And I've absolutely loved it. It's been a space of life. It's been a pocket of life. Like the young adults space, the prayer meetings before our time together, the time together in the field, pockets of life. And relationships, just relationships one-on-one, or I had supper with a bunch of friends the other day, and I felt like it was a pocket of life, like a wildfire. And I was really challenged that this is going to be thematic as we move forward. There's going to be pockets of life and power and vibrancy springing up everywhere. Not in a centralized way, in a scattered way. Got me excited. And we started to think about a bit of language around this. Okay, what's God saying here? And this phrase started coming up over and over again. that small is big. Small is big. And how important it's been in my life to find small pockets of life in church where I'm growing and where I'm developing and where people are sharpening me and where, you know, the kind of the nitty-gritty of relationship and of walking out what it is to be God's people is kind of earthed. Small is big. If you're not in small environments, it's really harmful for your development, your growth, like walking with God. It's an empowering thing to be in small environments, even sometimes where people are irritating, or let's face it, you're irritating other people.
I had a good joke and the microphone wasn't on.
Oh, mate, the moment's gone.
The moment's passed. I was going to say, I feel like you're pointing at me a lot when you're talking about annoying.
When you're just annoying people.
But it's fine, the moment passed. It's cool. No, it wasn't funny anyway.
And there's a scripture in Hebrews that says, meet together daily as long as it's called today. Meet together daily as long as it's called today. Now, that always challenges me because it's so antithetical to the way we do church, isn't it? We sort of come together once a week. But these smaller environments, they give us more of a daily connection with people. And I remember some 8 years ago, I had a friend who said, we responded to a word that we'd heard, which was about hearing the word of God for today, the daily bread of God today. And if you haven't heard the word of God for today, you've missed a day. And so he said to me, I'm going to send you a WhatsApp every day of what God's saying. And he has done that every single day. And the group of men that he has shared that with has grown to around about 25. And that's been a faithful journey. But there's been a day-to-dayness of it, which is possible in the small and not in the big. I want to leave you with just a moment of reflection on this one point. You know, you may be sat here thinking, I don't feel like I'm involved in a pocket of life, a wildfire. Or you may be thinking, I could see myself sparking a wildfire, like one of these little pockets of life. Maybe there's a relationship or a friendship or a group that you have in mind where you think of a pocket of life. I just want you to reflect for a minute. Where is God calling me to start a pocket of life? Where can I bring a spark of life? Who can I encourage? Who can I walk with? And that is very much down to you, because you are uniquely you. God has put you in a place at this time. He's put you here right now for such a time as this. So let's just think for a minute. Where could you see yourself sparking something?
I'm not a particularly self-reflective person in general, so I find stuff like this actually really helpful. And this is why we wanted to share it with you today, that it's not going to be another, here's loads of things to think about, but it's more a think back. And what has God actually been doing? Like, where have you found the moments of life over the past 3 months? And hopefully this is going to give you a lot to take away and think about and reflect on in your own journey as well. Even if you weren't with us for the time in the field and you're new today, hopefully you're getting a glimpse of what the story has started to look like over the past 3 months. I'm going to share one final memory. We could go on for ages, and especially, you know, even the memories that came out at the beginning. There's so much here. And the idea is this just starts or continues the conversation rather than has anything final about it. But do you remember when we had brunch together on that Sunday, where we reorientated the whole service around food, and Joel in particular, who was booing at us earlier, that was potentially Joel's favorite Sunday, and it was one of mine as well. There was something about it. We talked that week about the church being marked by love, but the whole point was that we were going to break bread together as a family and share food, and there was that amazing brunch put on. And I remember in the staff meeting after that Sunday, a lot of the staff shared that many of you, the congregation, had come up to various staff members and said, thank you. Thank you for putting on the brunch. Thank you for putting on all of this amazing food. And we reflected in that staff meeting that, yes, of course, some people did some organization. But actually, it wasn't the staff putting on the brunch for the church. It was the church putting and staff members in the first place to put on brunch. Of actually one of the things that we feel like God is taking us, the journey he's taking us all on, is from consumer to contributor when it comes to his church. Actually, the church has never been about on-demand entertainment. The church has never been about coming and just getting what you want and leaving. The church has always been about this family culture, this community where everyone brings something. It's the picture of the family Christmas lunch, right? And everyone in the extended family is doing something. Someone's peeling the potatoes, someone's laying the table, someone's, I don't know, all of the other things you do for Christmas lunch. I'm an expert at Christmas lunches. Yeah, it's because I was always put on the table laying, so I was not let near the food. But we spoke, especially nearer the end of the time in the field, on things like the church as a body or the church as an army. And all of those had pictures. And of course, church as a family was last week. All of them were the same picture, right? Just expressed in different ways. That God calls his people to bring something to the table, to participate. We all go through seasons where we need to sit on the fringe for a while, and that's also okay, by the way. Sometimes you can mishear this message as I've got to be doing everything all of the time in a church context. That's so far from the message. The message is that we bring something to the table, and then there's times when we're wounded and we can bring nothing, and someone else supports us by them bringing their something. And then at another time, you're stronger again, and you help someone else who's in trouble. But that to me was just, that picture of brunch was a really, really important picture to me. It was a picture of teamwork. It was a picture of participation. And it was a picture of contribution. And that, I think, is another thing that we're going to really be stepping into as we think about Ecclesia, as we think about pockets of life. It's not about everyone serving on a team on a Sunday. It's everyone doing something in the kingdom of God, bringing their gifts, bringing their parts. And Tim, I know it reminded you of the prophecy that Mark Isles gave, so...
Yeah, I don't know if, who knows what we're talking about when we say that Mark Isles came and gave a prophecy in 2019. So he just spoke a word over us and gave it to us as a church in 2019, as you will note, was just a few months before, well, actually it was about 7 or 8 months before COVID. And he said, I feel like you're gonna, as a church, you're going to be going through a time of change where you don't have time to think about shifting through the gears. It's just going to be on you. And then we went into COVID. And it was just a really interesting word in lots of different ways. But one of the things was he talked about going from a time of preparation to a time of participation. He talked about people stepping back who had been on the front lines. He talked about people who had been back stepping forward. But he talked about this in the context of all the stuff we've been talking about, of family, of participation, of stepping in. I want to reaffirm what I said a minute ago, which is you are uniquely you. The most beautiful picture of this church, of family, is when the unique people in this church bring what God's called them to be, to the picture. It's the most incredible thing. It's much better than any big meeting we've ever done. It's much better than any big team effort we've ever done to do an event. when everyone brings what they can bring and is authentically who God called them to be. It's like life. It's like beauty to me. I love it. And I love it when I see someone moving in what God's called them to move in. Because I know for a fact when you do that, it starts unlocking the people around you. So I was so encouraged to look back at Mark Arl's word of stepping forward, stepping back. It was like a line dance in my head. But participation and everyone engaged and involved. You know, I think we've spoken about different things, but the subject has been the same. Jesus is the head. Jesus is the capstone. Jesus is the cornerstone. Jesus is the focus. Jesus is the table. Jesus is love. Jesus is hope. Jesus is grace. Jesus is unity. You know, it's all around Christ.
Knowing him.
It's all around.
And making him known.
Knowing him.
And as we sort of gather and
I think it's really important that we say this, everything slowly, and that in everything that we're asking from you, and everything we're asking from this kid in Christ, like a wonderful new everyone start a lovely, wonderful new small group. We're asking each of you to thoughtfully say, Jesus, why have you created me in this time, in this place? What can I bring? And that actually this journey has brought us to a place where we're saying, we're all ready to step forward. We're all ready to participate in the way that God has called us to uniquely do in the empowering of Jesus. It's on him. He's the foundation. He's the capstone. He's the cornerstone. He's the head of the body and the lead in this family. Anything else you want to say on that, Bud?
Yeah, I was going to share, I think, just some more of the language that was shared with us over the past couple of weeks is the language of 1 degree shifts. Sometimes you can hear some of this and be like, oh, that sounds quite radical, like we're moving to this place of, you know, the church scattered. But actually, this under the banner of everything slowly, the language of 1 degree shifts is really helpful, and I think it's helpful in our own lives as well, that we're not changing everything dramatically. We're changing everything a bit, and that's the plan, because we feel like God is moving the emphasis to equip each and every one of us out there to make a kingdom, to be wildfires, to see pockets of life spring up everywhere. But it's not about either changing everything that you're doing. Rather, it's about doing what you're doing, perhaps with a slightly different intentionality, or realizing that God might have a purpose for you in that space, or in this family, or in this gathering. And 1 degree shifts has just really helped me in my thinking of this is sort of the direction we're going. God's moving us, but gently and carefully and slowly, because he doesn't want to lose anyone on this journey. This is a family journey, and we want to do it together, so it will be slow.
Yeah, absolutely. I wonder if we just take a moment. It's not a throwaway comment to say that Jesus is the center and the hope for every aspect of what we're talking about. It is the truth. In fact, the truth of the matter is, without him at the core, there's no hope. And so, as we think about all these things, I'm just going to invite the Holy Spirit to begin to speak to us and to lead us. There's going to be an opportunity to pray. In many ways, I feel like Ben's saying, it's the 1 degree shift. All we've really experienced for me has allowed us just to go, just maybe correct our focus slightly and say, actually, we want to build towards a place where everyone feels really empowered in their place, like wherever you are, that you're carrying the kingdom of God wherever you are. So I wonder if we could just close our eyes for a minute, and we're going to not walk past that speaker.
We're going to pray. We're just going to invite the Holy Spirit to say what he wants to say. Lord, we want to listen to you. We want to invite you, Holy Spirit, now to speak. Off the back of all that we've been talking about here, Lord Jesus, we recognize you've got us on a journey, and a journey is something we embark on with you, and we ask you to guide our steps. Lord, you are a light to our path. You're a light to our path. I just want to open the floor. If anyone wants to pray, if anyone wants to also invite God to speak, if anyone's got something they want to ask for, let's just do that. Let's be open. Holy Spirit, we welcome you. Yeah, Lord, I'm so grateful to you. What's come through all of this is your love for the church, your love for your people. Lord, how gentle you are, how you call us and you draw us and you love us and you breathe purpose and hope and, Lord, even joy into all that we do. Father, thank you that you love your church. Thank you that you love each and every one of us here. And that you called us according to your purpose. Thank you, Lord, you've designed each person uniquely. And you've placed each person uniquely. Lord, we pray that you'd be speaking to us about our unique shape and your headship. And draw us, Lord, into all that you want us to step into. And I want to proclaim, I believe that this will be a time where you see breakthrough, where you see God giving you impetus and that fire, that spark, where you've wanted it to be so badly. In your time together, in your time, in your sphere, that God is going to actually ignite some stuff. That actually, I believe he's got us here in this moment for a purpose. And the turning outwards and the asking God, okay, how do you want me to move, is an exciting place. And you don't have to do it quickly. Just that word, just everything slowly. Just breathe and let God do his thing. You don't have to rush anything or push anything. God has got you in this moment and he's leading you to a new place of effectiveness in your day-to-day and to us, for us, a new place as a church of seeing what he's placed us in. Lord, we thank you for your presence in this.
Guys, we're going to respond by singing about Jesus, our cornerstone. Would you like to stand? Let's sing, "My hope is built on nothing less."
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness,
but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Sing again, "My hope is built."
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Oh, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Let's sing, "Christ alone, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, and faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone."
Sing out.
"Christ alone, made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Oh, Christ alone. In the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all."
There's an opportunity to pray with someone at the front here if you want to do that, guys. Thanks. It's been awesome. Cheers. Love worshipping. Thank you, Lord. Yeah. In here and Remember, we're back here at 3:30 next week for coffee, and then 4 o'clock together. And then a week after, we're doing something called the Big Small Weekend. We'll tell you more about that at another time. All right, bless you guys. Grab a coffee, come pray. Let's be thinking about those things, eh? At another time. All right, bless you guys. Grab a coffee, come pray. Let's be thinking about those things, eh?